welcoming back one of Yaf's favorite speakers, very energetic for one of our favorite speeches, Dr. Burt Folsom.
Oh, thank you! Yay! No way! Thank you! Thank you! It's good to be back. And it's good to be back. And I want to talk this afternoon about a more recent time period, the 1920s and 30s. It's a little bit comparative history. I'm comparing two decades. The reason I'm doing it is because the 1920s, and I teach American economic history, the 1920s was the most prosperous decade in the 1920s, even more so than the Reagan years, although they were very close. The most depressed decade in American history was the next decade. If you're a historian, you're interested in these kinds of comparisons. What did we do in the 20s that we didn't do in the 30s? And how does that help us understand why the 1920s worked and the 1930s failed and was a depression? It's the difference between the roaring 20s and the depressed 30s. If you think about it, this comparative way of looking things, it's what historians like to do. But that helped me to understand the founders on this slavery issue, for example, which we talked about this morning, because I said America's built on an idea. No other country is founded on an idea. Usually it's a territorial grab by people. No other country is founded on an idea. The one exception possibly might be Israel, right? So there's a possible exception that came later. But certainly when America was founded, no other country was founded on an idea. And you look at that idea, no other country, although you had philosophers like John Locke, who was mentioned, talked about in Britain, no other country made any moves to abolish slavery. It had been part of human history for thousands of years. So when the founders made moves to undermine slavery, that is unique and needs to be pointed out that other nations and leaders in those nations at that time were not doing that. And it's interesting that 100 years after doing it, slavery was virtually abolished everywhere in the world. I'd say that's a pretty successful idea. Now, the 20s and 30s fit into this. I want to look at the 20s. It came right after the 20s start right after World War I. And wars always create confusion, and that's where I want to begin this, because when it came to 1920, there was much confusion in the United States. Who were the presidents, by the way, in the 1920s? Somebody? Yes?
Wilson, Harding, Coolidge.
Wow, that's good. There's a guy who's got them in sequence. Thank you. Wilson at the very first year of the 20s. And then Harding is elected. Coolidge was his vice president, and then Harding died in office. But Coolidge and Harding were on the same page. So Coolidge followed through. So those two presidents have 8 of the 10 years of the 1920s. So it's mostly Harding and Coolidge. And then Hoover came afterwards, just for 1 year. Like Wilson was in for the first year, Harding was in for the last year, in the middle 8 years, Harding and Coolidge. Yes, that's right. Harding, when he became president, was facing a lot of bad stuff. It's often underrated what kind of bad stuff it was. Let's look at the national debt. We look at the national debt. What's the national debt today? About $20 trillion. It's going to seem small by comparison, but then again, we were a smaller nation. Before World War I, our national debt, I put a B here for billion, was $1 billion. That's 100 years ago. Our national debt was $1 billion. So, I mean, $20 trillion, you can see, is a rather steep increase. Now, $1 billion had more purchasing power than it does now. But $1 billion, in other words, from the Revolutionary War through the Civil War and all of that, the amount of debt that we accumulated as a nation was $1 billion. In 1920, after World War I, the national debt was $24 billion. We never have had anywhere near in our history an increase like that. And what that means, because when you owe a debt, you have to pay an annual interest on the money you borrowed. The annual interest was almost $1 billion a year. In other words, before World War I, we had an entire national debt, $1 billion. After World War I, you almost, it was really $800 million, so it wasn't quite $1 billion. But you had almost $1 billion every year in debt, in interest payment, without reducing the debt. That's dramatic. And whoever comes in really is facing difficulties. Unemployment rate. Soldiers came home. 4 million of them fought in World War I. Not many jobs were waiting for them. Unemployment was 12%. Not very often in American history do we get double-digit unemployment. But we did in 1919 and 1920. Here, get this. The income tax first came into existence under Woodrow Wilson in 19... Does anybody know? 19... That's okay.
Is it 1917?
Close. 1913. There was a big increase in 17. So it had only been in for 7 years. When it came in, they said, oh, it'll just be small. It started at 7% as a top rate. Do you think John D. Rockefeller could afford 7%? Yeah. Here was the tax rate under Woodrow Wilson. The top rate is 73%. Now, the bottom rate is 4. Maybe I ought to put a 4 here. 4% is what people... And you had an exemption, too, so you didn't have to pay anything if you earned a low amount. And then it started at 4% and went up to 73% on top incomes. So millionaires had to pay 73%. Now, the annual federal budget per year was $6.5 billion. That's what it costs to support the federal government and all its programs, military and otherwise, $6.5 billion. That's the state of the economy in 1920. One of the reasons I'm excited about Harding and Coolidge, and I'm anxious to talk about this, you hear so much bad news, right? Oh, it's grim. I want to show you a success story. What I want to do is show you what it looked like after 8 years of Harding and Coolidge, and then I want to talk about what good things happened in between. You know, I'm giving you basic information here, and then I want to fill it in with some of the stories that made the 1920s roar. First of all, let's start with the tax rate. Harding and Coolidge, when they got in, said, the reason, you know, because you say, where do we start? What do we do? This is going to be 1930. They said, here's Harding and Coolidge both said this. I think we need to lower this because because the first thought Wilson and others had, some of the others had, is let's raise that to help pay off the debt. Harding said, I disagree with that theory. Because right now, entrepreneurs will not invest if you say you're going to take $3 out of every $4 out of their wallets if they make a profit. Does that make sense? Yeah. What's your name?
Madeline.
If you were to take all the money you have and someone said, I have an investment, it may be successful, it may not. But if it is successful, all the investment you give me, I'll take 3/4 of it in taxes. Would that make you attracted to that investment?
No.
I don't think, you know, all of us think that's the way I think. And Harding said, I think that's the way most people think. He got in one of the wealthiest people in the United States, the third wealthiest person, as Secretary of Treasury. I have an essay on him in the book that we're giving you here, The Myth of the Robber Barons, which I wrote. His name is Andrew Mellon. A whole chapter on here where I describe a lot of that. Mellon and Harding, that was funny, they asked Mellon, what do you think about this? He said, too high. And they said, are you sure? And he said, well, I've taken all my investments out of the United States. Well, that kind of answers your question, doesn't it? And they said, why? And they said, because there are other places I can get a better rate of return. You know, and some people said, you're not American. He said, you lower the rate and you'll see how American I am. We did. 25% was the new top rate. And I want to make this clear, they cut all rates. The bottom rate, instead of being 4%, was 1/2 of 1% at the end of the decade. In other words, proportionally, it was a bigger cut on the bottom than it was on the top. Mellon said, I want everybody to get a cut because I believe if you cut, the money will come back into the economy. And when Harding was funny at a cabinet meeting, he said, you really think so? He says, yeah, I think my friends are ready to invest. Well, I want to show you something. Mellon was right and Harding was right to trust him. Unemployment in 2 years, from 1921, when Harding took office, to 1923, the year he died. When he died, unemployment in this country after a tax cut was this. Do you find that interesting? 12-2, and I heard one person say, I have my census here. You're wrong. It's 2.4. Okay, I rounded it. Put 2.4. That was the unemployment rate. It averaged 3 for the decade. 3.3 to be precise. There is no president, since records have been kept, there's no set of presidencies that had unemployment rates so low as Harding and Coolidge. Since records have been kept, those two have the lowest in U.S. history. Do you find that kind of interesting? We cut this, the tax rate, and then this happens because the entrepreneurs came out of the woodwork and invested. Now, I know you're thinking, well, what about the debt? You cut the tax rate, the money is going to come in and we'll never pay off that debt. Gosh, anybody have a guess what the debt might be in 1930? Any speculation? Yes, at the back? 36 billion? And you might defend it by saying, well, we got unemployment, we got people employed, so that justifies that. No, actually, the national debt in 1930 was 16 billion. We cut one third off. I love the way Andrew Mellon, the Secretary of Treasury, said it. He was a soft-spoken guy. He said, 73% of nothing is nothing. 25% of something is something. And he said, if you get it down to 25%, you're going to have a lot of somethings. The revenue into the federal government from taxation went up. And for the first time in U.S. history, income tax revenue exceeded $1 billion a year when the tax rate was cut to 25%, top rate. And the poor people were only paying half of 1%. In fact, there are only about 5% of Americans paying any income tax at all. But there was a huge increase. The federal budget expenses under Harding and Coolidge cut to an average of $3.2 billion. It was funny because people said, you need programs to help the unemployed. And Harding and Coolidge said, no, we need to remove programs so that money can be saved so entrepreneurs can invest and put people to work. Do you get that, the two sides on that? We need to tax people to create programs to get people jobs. He said, no, you need to cut taxes and tax rates so that entrepreneurs will invest, and then you will have jobs. And because entrepreneurs are doing this, and because they're being taxed some on the revenue, the government's gaining instead of shoveling out money for a program. And by the way, if we take this group of people over here, on this part of the room, and say, you guys get to receive a subsidy from a program from the government. Sounds good. You guys have to pay for it. If they get the subsidy, you can see why they're happy and they might have money. But if you're paying for it, you can no longer buy a new shirt, a a tie, an Xbox, whatever. You know, a few more months on your phone. You see what I mean? Jobs are lost over here because you just paid the revenue to them. So that although they gain, you lose, and the net is no jobs. Because what's gained over here is lost over here. And that's what Harding and Mellon understood. They said, when you play the tax game, you shuffle money to someone, and they may be your voters. And that's why politicians like to do it. But that's not going to help the economy. You cut the tax rate, freedom turns people loose, success is the result. Now, I've got to go into what were some of, you know, I've given you the outline, what's some of the substance that's going on in here that made the 1920s the roaring 20s? The substance, think of some of the inventions. Radio. We don't think of radio as being that great today. We think of television, maybe. But see, television followed radio. The idea is you can now communicate with large numbers of people in an easy way. And radio provides that. An incredible invention. And we had a lot of companies benefiting from the radio. And of course, you're cutting taxes. So you have people willing to invest because they say, ooh, I can make profits in radio. They're not saying, oh, I better not invest because they're going to take 73% of my money if I'm really successful. They're saying the worst they can do is take 25% of my money, which still sounds like quite a bit, I think. Anyway, we have, ooh, a good one here. Here's a real invention for you. Air conditioning. Technically, it was invented earlier, but the first air conditioner was sold in 1923. You get that? You cut the taxes, and now Willis Carrier from New York. I love that. A New Yorker invented air conditioning. Yeah, who's the fellow from Savannah? Yeah, it ought to be Savannah inventing air conditioning. Yeah, right. It's not. It was a New Yorker, and I love it. He was a professor, sort of, and he was an absent-minded professor, which makes me like him even more. And he one time was on a train, and he was going to get off, and he forgot where he was supposed to go. And he couldn't get on the phone and call his wife, where am I supposed to be going? And he had to get off to call, and then the train left and all this. Oh, delightful complications, but he was a good inventor. He invented air conditioning. It started out almost as an accident because he was trying to invent a process to reduce the humidity in a room so that newspaper print would dry quicker. Because a newspaper print company hired him in New York to say, if you can dehumidify the room, then maybe our print will dry and it won't smear when a page touches another page. And so he went to work, and when he did that, he thought, you know, I'm cooling off the room. I wonder if I could work this in another angle. But see, he can't do it if the tax rate's 73% because they'll take all your money if you succeed. It wasn't until the tax rate gets down that you're ready to take the investment chance. The first institution or group to buy an air conditioner, and it was a huge contraption back then, was a movie theater. Because the summer was the dull time for movies. It was hot theater and movies. The movies were, you know, there'd be a lot of movie in the winter. People would go, and then in the summer they wouldn't go, and ticket sales would be down. Then they'd be back up in the fall and winter. So they thought, if we can get an air conditioner, it was the Rivoli Theater in New York City, said, if we can get an air conditioning, maybe people will like it. They didn't just like it. There were 300 other theaters that got air conditioning before the end of the 1930s. And then you expand. Home units don't come in until the 1960s. You can ask your grandparents on that, if they remember when air conditioner came into their house. Home units, see, it's kind of a slow evolution because it took a while for the smaller home units to come in and be marketable and profitable. Anyway, air conditioning, oh, great inventions. And I love this one. Once the theaters were air-conditioned and the attendance went up, the invention of the talking movies. They were silent movies. But now that the attendance was up, you had entrepreneurs at Warner Brothers that were willing to speculate and say, now that we've got good attendance, maybe talking movies will fit in and we can do that. Do you notice one invention leads to another? 1927, the first talking movies. Yeah. And let's see, some other inventions. I like this one. The invention was called hookless number two. That sounds weird, doesn't it? Hookless number two. Invented by a Swedish immigrant. The nice thing about entrepreneurship, it knows no rich, no poor. Does that sound familiar? Slave nor free, male nor female. Good ideas are what count. And this immigrant from Sweden named Gideon Sundback had an idea for hookless. He called it hookless number two. We call it today the zipper. And we all use it. We probably all have it. And it's functioning, I hope. I hope mine is. We're all functioning. Our zippers are functioning. And he had the zipper. Gideon Sundback, when he took it to the patent office, they said, well, you know, he was showing them how it worked. He says, that's something I've never seen before. I tell you what, we have a kind of a generous attitude toward patents, so I'm going to give you a patent for this, but I cannot imagine a use for it. It takes an entrepreneur. It takes somebody who has thoughts in marketing. He puts the zipper out there. It's a bomb for a while. And then B.F. Goodrich buys it. And the first product that is mass-produced with a zipper is women's galoshes. And they marketed them in Good Housekeeping, and they had a woman with her, is a singular galosh? I don't know. Anyway, one of her galoshes or a galosh, she put it up there, and it had a woman there, and she was pulling the hookless number two. But Madison Avenue and the advertisers decided to change it, and they had as the caption under her picture, "Zip her up." And zipper replaced hookless number two as the name. And people thought, wow, we can use it for clothes. My father grew up before the invention of the zipper. And, I, you know, as a kid, I'm sitting there, Dad, I mean, you know, how'd you keep it all? How'd you do without a zipper? And he's saying, we used buttons. Buttons were what you used before a zipper. So zippers come in and become dominant. Geez, these are the greatest inventions since sliced bread. Sliced bread was invented in the 1920s. Otto Rohweder from Davenport, Iowa. I like that, a good farm country there, is inventing sliced bread. The toaster is invented shortly thereafter. So you have sliced bread and a toaster, all of these. Now, what I want you to see with this flurry of inventions, but I want to do one more first because it's one of my favorites. And I used it last night and thought about it last night. It was invented by a teenager, right? There is no male nor female, nor slave nor free, nor Jew nor Greek, nor old person or young person. Yeah, I mean, Josephine Dillon invented the dishwasher. Women entrepreneurs, see, there's openings. If you have a good idea, you have an opportunity. The teenager, 16 years old, Lionel Sternberger in Pasadena, California. Somebody have any idea what this teenager invented? Yes?
Burgers?
You're close. You're very, very close. Isn't that wonderful? See, the clue is in the name Sternberger. He invented a burger. He invented the cheeseburger. He invented the cheeseburger. And, oh, Lionel Sternberger, he's such a wonderful. And he had big restaurants, and he called it the cheese hamburger at first and then changed it, shortened it to cheeseburger. And he invented it in 1924 when he was 16 years old. Now, there's a sadness to my Lionel Sternberger's story. And that is that most people who invent something like to use their product, I mean, like Gideon Sundback used his zipper. I mean, Warner Brothers was watching movies and all of this. And Willis Carrier was using his air conditioner. Right? You use your inventions. Well, Lionel Sternberger ate so many cheeseburgers that he got hugely obese. and died at age 57. So I'm sorry about... But put that aside. I want the teenage inventor to be acknowledged and remembered. So we have that going on too. Now, I say all these inventions to fill out what's going on in the 1920s. Because what's happening is, once you get entrepreneurs with this tax rate turned loose, you get a whole bunch of new inventions. By the end of the decade, and I did some calculations on this, we added to our GNP 25%. 25% is the equivalent of adding to your GNP the entire states of California and Texas in today. In one decade, you did the equivalent of add all the industry and earnings in California and Texas in one decade. That is why after World War I, the Americans surged into incredible world leadership. No other nation took this step, and no other nation had this kind of prosperity in the 1920s. Which leads to the question, what in the world went wrong? What went wrong, unfortunately, there are two words. Herbert Hoover. The Republican Party had two wings to the party as it does today. You had kind of the establishment wing that, oh, I don't want to do all this, and that was Hoover. Hoover became president, and Hoover wanted to say, well, maybe we need a few more subsidies and this kind of thing. Some of this was not his fault. For example, the Federal Reserve, which he does not have direct control over, raised interest rates, which made money harder to borrow. Milton Friedman, the economist, argued that this was a major cause of the Great Depression, and he won the Nobel Prize, largely on the basis of his book, A Monetary History of the United States. So I have to give that credit. But notice that's a government program. You're intervening with the Federal Reserve on the economy. Some of the other things are more Hoover's fault. For example, Hoover signed a bill that provided the highest tariff in American history called the Smoot-Hawley tariff. Some of you may have heard of that. The problem with a high tariff, it increases dramatically the price of importing something. And you may think, well, that's tough for the foreigners. Not completely, because the foreigners then put tariffs on our material. Let me give you just an example. Switzerland, their number one export is watches. We put a tariff on their watches so we'd protect American watchmakers and they'd sell more. Our American watchmakers weren't as good as the Swiss, so they loved that. Switzerland turned around and put a tariff on our typewriters and our automobiles. Our automobiles and other European countries then did the same thing, because we tariffed Britain their towels and their textiles. We tariffed the olives that came in from Spain. We put tariffs all over the place so that the European countries then raised their tariffs on our materials. And then what happened was our automakers lost their foreign market. We sold in this country 5 million automobiles in 1929. 3 years later, 1932, our auto sales in the United States were 1.6 million. Now, there were other things going in other than just the export, but the collapse of the export market heavily contributed to that decline. So what I'm saying is that there are disasters that come when you meddle sometimes with the tariffs. I also want to say Hoover introduced some farm subsidies that backfired. Hoover then, businesses started to fail, and so Hoover had government bailouts. And the bailouts were, if you had political connections, you got bailed out, and if you didn't, you didn't get bailed out. The end result was that, unfortunately, let me get my chart here, by 1933, the tax rate, or the unemployment rate went from 2 and 3% to about 25%. The national debt started going back up. The tax rate Hoover raised to over 60%, choking off entrepreneurship, which choked off more investment. Then Franklin Roosevelt came in saying, this is ridiculous. But when he got in, he did more of the same thing. He was Hoover on steroids. Roosevelt came in and raised the tax rate to 79%. Later, he raised the top rate to 90%. Then to 94% on all income over $200,000. You paid 94% on every dollar you earned over $200,000. And then Roosevelt had the remarkable 100.6% proposal for millionaires. By the way, how many have heard of that? Oh, good. Where'd you hear about it? Oh, but you remembered. Thank you. Okay. Sometimes as a historian, you know, I've been a professor for decades, and I thought, I don't want to write on Roosevelt, but I have to, because no one else is thinking through the problem. And so at Hillsdale College, you know, I wrote this book, co-authored it with my wife, and Roosevelt proposed 100, he had a 94% rate, but he proposed 100.6, and he said, listen to this, the Senate, I have all the Senate hearings, the leader of the Democrats in the House of Representatives, by the way, how many of you have your teachers like Franklin Roosevelt? Wow. How many have said, boy, I like Franklin Roosevelt, and that 100.6% tax is not bad either, huh? Yeah. Listen to this. Emanuel Seller in the House of Representatives said, the government can at any time make income taxes as thumping big as the necessities of war require. Thus, if any plan does not raise enough money, taxes can at any time be increased. The government always has a moral, if not an actual lien, that is a right, to all of our income. Does anybody see a difference between that and the founders? Right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. If somebody is taxing you 100.6%, I would think that your liberty is under siege. And I'll tell you this, your pursuit of happiness sure is. That's interesting because it's contrary. Can you see where we're moving in this country in a direction contrary to the founders with Roosevelt? Senator Chandler from Kentucky said this, Mr. President, all of us owe the government. We owe it for everything we have. Think of that, the founder's view. God gave you, every one of you, the right to life and liberty. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill. You, every one of you, has the right to life and liberty. And government we put in as a protection so that people can't take that from you. Now, they're saying, we owe government for everything we have, and we're considering and debating in this country a 100.6% income tax. One of the reasons that I'm much more relaxed and optimistic in this frenetic world is that I see what it was sometimes in the past and the desperation we were in there. Can you imagine if we were having a YAF conference and there'd be people coming in here saying, 100% tax our liberty's gone forever. Well, see, you know what? We had sensible people who ultimately are going to prevail. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. One of them is not Senator Chandler. He said, we owe the government for everything we have. That is the basis of obligation, and the government can take everything we have if the government needs it. The government can assert its right to have all the taxes it needs for any purpose, either now or at any time in the future. And the Senate Majority Leader said after that speech, he said, I thank the senator from Kentucky. That is all there is to this problem. The Majority Leader of the Democratic Party, which had a majority in the Senate, said that. And that's why it was dangerous that that was going to become law. The nice thing is I always have a cheery note here. It's hard to have a cheery note when I just said that, isn't it? But here's a cheery note. Did anybody raise an objection? Yes. And I'm happy to say he was from Massachusetts. Charles Gifford, congressman. It was proposed for 3 years. We were going to have 100.6 for a three-year period as a trial. Gifford said this, for 3 long years he has to pay more than he receives. How does he pay his other taxes? Because the states had tax bills. How does he pay his other taxes? How does he meet his living expenses? Isn't it nice when somebody asks the obvious? It's refreshing. He asked the obvious. And a congressman responded to this. Who's Now, mind you, most of the Democrats are defending this. And then he says, well, how does someone live if he pays 100.6? By the way, if you earn $1 million, your tax rate, your tax bill is $1,006,000. So you give everything you earn, the whole million, plus $6,000 is what you owe the government. That congressman who was defending him is from Tennessee. A Democrat. The Democrats used to be strong in Tennessee. Jerry Cooper, he said this. Not to worry, Congressman Gifford, not to worry. Quote, it may not be possible to pay more than 1 year's taxes out of 1 year's income. But with few exceptions, persons in the higher brackets have assets already that they can use to pay the income tax. Oh, that's a relief. Boy. Whew. Okay. Well, let's go for it then, huh? Yeah. By the way, does anybody understand why we had double-digit unemployment all through every year of the 1930s, the only decade in our history? Is there some kind of bell, I wonder, that's ringing among my fellow historians? I wonder why we have double-digit unemployment. Yes?
Maybe the New Deal.
Maybe the New Deal. Yeah. I think so. And because you're, now, this doesn't even get into the New Deal itself. For example, yes. Let me do it this. We had a program called the AAA. Some of you heard of that. I'm going to go through the two major New Deal programs that Roosevelt instituted when he became president. The AAA, Agricultural Adjustment Act. Now, this is what happens. It was such a wild, this is a piece of farmland here. This is such a wild program, the AAA, that it could only have been invented by a college professor. It's the only person who could possibly have invented this. And it is. Professor Black at Harvard, an economist, invented this. And what the AAA is, farmers are poor and they're not able to sell their crops for very much. And so he said the solution is to pay the farmers not to produce. Wow! Let them take as much as 1/4 of their land and then pay them not to produce on that land. Wow. The funny thing was when they passed this, most of the farmers, first of all, they sneaked and planted on the land anyway. Second, they took the money and bought fertilizer and did more on this land than the rest. By the way, how do you get out of a depression by producing less? You know, how many have heard of hungry people in the Great Depression? Yeah, cutting 1/4 of the land may not be the best solution to that problem. Can you see, how are you going to get out of the depression by paying farmers not to produce? You're only going to increase the tax rate like to this, you get it? We packed more. And then the more you build that up, the entrepreneurs aren't going to invest, and you remain year after year after year in depression. The WPA, have some of you heard of the WPA? Maybe you've had great-grandparents, maybe some of you who worked on the WPA. The WPA stands for Works Progress Administration, and the idea, Works Progress Administration, is that you have people who are unemployed. Let's have them build roads and stuff. Let's put aside that not everybody who's unemployed knows how to build a road. Some of the roads were so horribly built they had to be rebuilt later, but put that aside for a minute. Okay, you're going to build roads. When I began to research this for my book, New Deal or Raw Deal, I want to read you if you can get an idea. We're going to tax people to build roads. V.G. Copeland, the Democratic County Chairman of Indiana, said, quote, what I think will help, he's the Democratic Chairman, of Indiana, state of Indiana. What I think will help is to change the WPA management from top to bottom. Put men in there who are in favor of using these Democratic projects to make votes for the Democratic Party. In other words, you give the Democrats in their districts the money, and then they refurbish it. Occasionally, Republicans would get some money. Mostly, it goes to Democratic districts. James Doherty in New Hampshire said, he's, quote, "It is my personal belief that to the victor belong the spoils, that the Democrats should be holding most of these WPA positions so that we might strengthen our fences for the 1940 elections." I like the WPA head of, in New Jersey, a man by the name of Frank Haig. He was head of the WPA in New Jersey. And he always answered, he was the head of the WPA, and he always answered his phone at the WPA office. He always answered at Democratic headquarters. Because you had to have recommendations that you were a genuine Democrat before you could be considered for a WPA position. Thus, the WPA does not get us out of the Great Depression. But what I'm trying to explain, you know, a lot of people say, well, if it didn't get us out of the Depression, how come it keeps staying around? Because it made so many votes for the Democratic Party. Now, this is going to be a disaster, but I have some good news, and that is Franklin Roosevelt kept winning term, and then he said, well, I think I'll run for a third term. Then I think I'll run for a fourth term. And when he ran and was elected to a fourth term, he was already planning for a fifth term. In fact, I did some calculations on his age. If he had run for a fifth term and won, and run for a sixth term and won, he would have been younger in that sixth term than Reagan was in his second term. So Roosevelt was using this to make votes and elections for the Democratic Party. When he died, the Republicans immediately got in and they cut the income tax and they cut the federal spending, and immediately, and this was after World War II, and immediately after that, the economy began recovering, and you get television developed, the Xerox machine developed, you know, the whole auto industry begins to go wild with sales, with innovations and sales. The ballpoint pen is invented. You know, you get all sorts of inventions, and you get a recovery. We cut the corporate tax rate from 90% to 33%. Now, what I'm saying here is this: you cut the tax rate and you got another recovery. Interesting. I have to just do a personal note and get off it. I'm born not long after World War II. Now, what I'm saying here is this: because the Republicans and some Democrats too got in there and cut this income tax, it allowed the entrepreneurs to come in and invent their televisions and their copy machines and their Holiday Inn hotels and McDonald's and all. I mean, you go down the list of all these inventions after World War II that came in, just like the 1920s. Because those came in, my father had a job. Because my father had a job, I had an upbringing and I had a life where I was able to have life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I wanted to become a college professor. And one of the reasons I wanted to is I thought college, being a college professor, you have a chance to have an impact on people. It's so much is a battle of ideas. And the idea of freedom is an idea worth dedicating a lot of my life to defend. And I'm delighted because YAF thinks exactly the same way. And so YAF is promoting this, and I'm happy to be part of it. But I had my chance because of this. I want your generation, and I'm still here because I want to see freedom, which worked when we finally, it worked in the 20s, and then it finally worked when we got rid of the New Deal and Franklin Roosevelt. When that happened, I had a life, I had a career, I got to enjoy the American dream, and I want to say you people have that chance too. And you can do it because those same ideas that worked in 1920s and 1940s will work today. Limited government, low taxes, turn the entrepreneurs loose, jobs get created, American prosperity is a result of that. opportunities for lots of people. And I mean that by black and white. In the 1920s, we had a doubling of college enrollment. Black, white, male, and female, doubling. Life expectancy increased by almost 6 years in the 1920s. Life expectancy fell in the 1930s by 0.4 years, according to the U.S. Census, from 63.3 to 62.9. Life expectancy was 63.3 in 1933, 62.9 7 years later. That is what I call life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. In the 20s, longer life, better health, lower life expectancy when you begin to have the higher unemployment and all that goes with it. I want to mention one final thing and turn it over for questions. Franklin Roosevelt, because he did not believe in the founders' what we would call natural rights, that everybody has a right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Rich people did not have a right to any income, or at least not much. He didn't get his 100% bill. He had to settle for 94%. That was the tax rate in our country for many years in the 40s. 94% on all income over $200,000. I still consider that a virtual confiscation and a violation of the Constitution's right to life, or the Declaration's right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. He also put 110,000 Japanese Americans in jail, in an internment camps, they called them, all around the country after World War I started because they were Japanese. The head of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, said there are only a handful of those people who are dangerous. Some people said, well, if there are only a handful that are dangerous, arrest or watch the handful and leave the rest alone. Roosevelt said, in effect, there are votes out there in California. Because when the Japanese are put in internment camps, their land has to be sold. And the Caucasians can get it cheap. Roosevelt won 4 House seats in California during the 40s. And right after the 1944 elections, he let those 110,000 come back. They were imprisoned just for being Japanese Americans. Some of them were born in the United States. Their fathers came over. They were born here. They committed no crime. Some of them served in the military with distinction. They ended up being put in there. Under Roosevelt, the Democratic Party had a denial of natural rights with rich people, with Japanese Americans. By the way, how many know that they were rectified? Every Japanese American was ultimately given some reparations for that. Who is the president under which they got reparations?
Reagan.
Ronald Reagan. The violation under Roosevelt, the apology, an official government apology, and a $20,000 for every Japanese American who was there who was in the camps, internment camps. Under Reagan, the violation under Roosevelt, the reward for those people who had been abused under President Reagan. Now, I want to mention one other group, and that's the blacks. Roosevelt did not want to give blacks civil rights. He was a racist. He didn't have the White House staff was segregated. His staff at his mansion in Hyde Park was segregated. He had another staff at his summer home in Georgia, and it was segregated. And he had, because Roosevelt had polio, he had a facility for polio people, but blacks were not allowed to be admitted. If you were black and you had polio, you were not allowed to be admitted to his facility, only if you were white. Franklin D. Roosevelt tacitly supported the Ku Klux Klan. The Ku Klux Klan, according to Eric Foner, who's a radical, really a leftist, says, hey, look, I got to admit the Ku Klux Klan was the terrorist arm of the Democratic Party in the late 1800s. Roosevelt appointed as his first choice to the Supreme Court Hugo Black from Alabama. Hugo Black was not only a member of the Ku Klux Klan, actively and encouraging it in Alabama, his campaign manager was the Grand Wizard of the Ku Klux Klan in Alabama, the number one Klansman in Alabama. Black won his election and was the first person Roosevelt appointed to the Supreme Court. What we have here is a situation where a denial of civil liberties is happening under Franklin Roosevelt. In poll after poll that has been taken of historians, the majority of historians, my peers, I have a PhD, I teach history, and I've been asked to participate in some of these polls. I've been a C-SPAN poll most recently. Franklin Roosevelt is consistently in these polls, even with me voting sometimes, is ranked ahead as a president, ahead of George Washington. My fellow historians rank him either number one or number two greatest president in U.S. history. One thing I want to do is try to just explain to you what I think is an alternate view of Roosevelt that you don't hear, and I've never seen it in any textbook presented. That's why I wrote I wrote one book, and then people started saying, well, what about the war? And so I had to write another one. By the way, who has a course that might be able to use? Here, you've been good. Take this. Who? Could somebody use the one with the 100? It's the only place with the 100% income tax that I know. Are you going to argue against it in class? Do you have an American history course?
Yes.
Oh, you take it. Hey, I have one more. Are you taking a history course?
Yes, sir.
Next semester.
This semester.
Yay! Woohoo! You don't know how much that delights me to imagine you in your class if the teacher is saying he's greater than George Washington and the fact that you are going to be there to offer an alternate view of Roosevelt's accomplishments. Anyway, let's open it up for questions. What I want to say is this. We have gone through negative periods in American history. The 1920s was great because we had freedom. The 1930s was depressed because we took that freedom away. We got the freedom back, and I got to have life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And I'm teaching this because I hope that politicians in authority will give you the right to have and enjoy that right as much as I have in my life. Yeah, or we have Raj. Go ahead. Fire away.
Nicholas Dunn, homeschooled.
Yes.
So my question was, what do you think about minimum wage? Because I know it was invented as part of, but around this same time, along with those ideas. Yeah.
It came in the 1930s. I have to admit, my first job was minimum wage. Back in my day, it was $1.60 an hour. And they were going to raise it to $2. I was working in a I was writing my PhD dissertation in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, at the University of Pittsburgh. And, oh, we have some Pittsburgh people? Good. Anyway, I was working in Oakland in an apartment complex in Pittsburgh as a doorman. And if people would come in, I'd help them get in. I had a buzzer, and I'd turn the lights on at night. And it was a job. I should have paid them $1.60 an hour because I worked for 8 hours at night, not every night, but some nights. And I couldn't do anything. I was isolated in that apartment. And so I had to write my dissertation. And I mean, I only had a little bit, you know, just let occasionally a tenant in or a tenant's guest and then turn on the lights at night so that people could see on the sidewalks. And that was my duties, and I got minimum wage. They were going to push minimum wage up to $2 an hour, and the outside guy from New York City who owned the apartment building came in, and he was working in an office next to mine. And I said, oh, hi there. You know, I was trying to be friendly. They're raising minimum wage. And he said, well, it's up to $2, and if it goes up to $2, we're going to mechanize every room so that they can control the buzzer from their room, and then we won't need anybody down here in your job. You are looking at someone who wrote a fast dissertation. I got out just in time before they mechanized it, and everybody was out of a job. Kiosks are coming into the fast food place. I've ordered, many of you have also, as we cease to have employment for young people. It's a shame because not long ago, on the Fortune 500 list, more Fortune 500 top executives in their life had worked in a fast food restaurant than any other occupation. They got their start and they went on to become CEOs, and now kiosks are getting their start. Now, if those kiosks run the country really well with good entrepreneurship, that's going to be wonderful. But I have a feeling people do it better, and I'm sorry that we're losing that. And jobs, unemployment always goes up when you pass. You know, it's great if you're covered and they don't phase you out. It's not so good if you're phased out, and I don't think it's very good for the country, even though some people will gain. Yeah, another question.
We'll go here back here. Hi, my name is Andrew Bruns. I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio.
You're from Ohio, good.
Yep, I was wondering where, this is not related to what you talked about, I was wondering where we could buy your book about the tax rate.
The book about, let me put it this way, the book about the tax rate in the 20s, you all have. It's in the book, The Myth of the Robber Barons, which Young America's Foundation sponsored. I would never have written that book if it hadn't been for Young America's Foundation. They encouraged me to write it, and they allowed me, paid me to set aside time that I could write it. I wrote that book because of Young Americans Foundation. That is where you get the story of the 20s, this one. Where you get the story afterwards is in my second, primarily my second book, FDR Goes to War, and somewhat in the earlier book, New Deal or Raw Deal. Because I felt that was important and no other person was talking about it. The tax rates. By the way, people say, you can't talk about tax rates with young people. I said, people understand money. I mean, I understood money when I was in high school. And when someone said, I'm going to take 3/4 of it, I understood it. So I don't think that's true. I think they get it. Yeah. Go ahead.
Tyler Medick from Temisco Canyon High School.
Yes.
What was the healthcare situation during these two decades between 1920 and 1940?
Ah, healthcare. You are responsible privately for your own healthcare. Now, sometimes companies gave you healthcare. And in the 1940s, companies did it voluntarily. And the reason they did it is they thought that creates an incentive for people to work at our company. So it was an add-on that some companies chose to do, and that's where you got the idea of your employer doing your health care. Even at the time, some of the employers said, I'm nervous about doing this because when people pay for their own health care, they use it sparingly only as they have need for it. When they can look to me for health care, they sometimes don't care and they don't ask the doctor what the bill's going to be and so on. It's never good to separate the person who's paying for your, doing your service from you who's conducting, or who is seeking the service. And by the way, Adam Smith, who wrote the great book, Wealth of Nations, said that especially applies, and I'm embarrassed to say this, to teaching. Teachers do not need tenure with automatic people in the classroom. They need to be paid on the basis of whether students are learning and whether they recommend that class to others, and that is your way to get the best teachers. Other questions? Okay.
Hi, Hope White from St. John Endicott High School in Washington State. I was wondering, so you're talking about subsidies for farmers, and do you think that farmers should get zero like grants or loans from the government or what?
Yes. In a nutshell, yes. Interestingly enough, sometimes I get students who are in the farming who say, yeah. And sometimes I get students who say, well, we'd go out of business if we didn't have a subsidy. But that's the point, isn't it? In other words, if you can't afford to be in a business, then maybe you ought to be in another business rather than having the government support you in the business that you're already in. In that case, we would have fewer people farming land. And if we ever had higher prices for crops, then they'd get back in. In other words, the amount of people in and out of farming would be dependent upon the prices of crops and the price of farmland rather than how much a government subsidy is kicking in. Because once the government subsidy kicks in, it's interesting because you always assume, well, it's being done rationally. What we found out is corn farmers had huge influence with the government, so we got a subsidy on corn. We didn't have a subsidy on alfalfa. You get it? In other words, if you do a crop that has a lot of people and influence, you get a subsidy. Otherwise, no. And so what happened was a lot of subsidies went to corn. And so because it went to corn, there was huge overproduction of corn, and then we didn't have as much hay and alfalfa. Because people were going where the subsidy was instead of going where the market should normally take it. And then we had way surpluses of some crops and shortages of others. It creates a haywire system when you pick and choose winners and losers of crops. And that's the case with industry as well. Thank you. Oh, you're funny.